There's free money lying around right now waiting for you to pick up, assuming you have the skills to predict the future. Here's how it works. On a prediction market, you can bet on whether an event will happen, and you'll be financially rewarded if you're right. You can bet on an event happening by buying shares for that outcome. If the event happens, then your shares can be redeemed for some amount of money, for example, $1 per share. Only shares for an outcome that actually occurred can be redeemed for money. This is what makes trading on prediction markets risky. If you buy shares in an outcome that doesn't happen, then you're out of luck and you don't get your money back. Just like in other financial markets, prices in prediction markets are not determined by the platform that enables buying and selling shares, but by the activity of every trader participating in the market. What makes things interesting is that the market price of an outcome on a prediction market can loosely be interpreted as the probability of that outcome occurring. Let's look at an example. Suppose there's an upcoming election between two candidates, Alpha and Beta. Alpha shares currently cost 75 cents, and Beta shares cost 25 cents. In that case, we say that the market roughly thinks that Alpha has a 75% chance of winning and a 25% chance of losing to Beta. Consider the case where you think Beta has a higher chance of winning than 25%. This means that you think the market is wrong. You think the actual probability is 90%, maybe because you have information that you think the market isn't accounting for. Then that means there's practically free money on the table. According to you, there's a 90% chance that you will quadruple your investment if you buy Beta shares, because you only need to pay 25 cents for those shares, and they'd be redeemable for $1 each if the event happens. On the other hand, there's only a 10% chance of losing your 25 cent per share investment. Beta shares seem like a good deal to you. Instead, according to your probabilities, buying Alpha shares would mean a 90% chance of losing 75 cents per share, and a 10% chance of making a 25 cent profit per share. Not a good deal. You can calculate exactly how much you expect to win by buying Beta shares, and how much you expect to lose by buying Alpha shares. By buying one Beta share, you think there's a 90% chance of making a 75 cent profit, and a 10% chance of losing 25 cents. The expected value is 65 cents. You can interpret this number as your average win if you repeat a bet with these payoffs and probabilities over and over again, assuming that the probabilities you're estimating are accurate. Instead, with Alpha shares, you have a 90% chance of losing 75 cents and a 10% chance of making a 25 cent profit, which amounts to an expected value of minus 65 cents. Therefore, on average, you expect to lose 65 cents if you bet on Alpha. Notice that if your probabilities were the same as the market's, then the expected value of buying shares would be zero, regardless of whether you buy yes or no shares. You can't make money if you don't add information to the market. Now, prediction markets also offer the option to sell shares after you've bought them. If you previously bought a share, but then some news comes out that makes you expect that the share price will drop from its current price, then you might want to sell it. In general, whenever there's a mismatch between what traders perceive to be the true probability of an event and the price of a share within a prediction market, traders in the market will keep buying the underpriced shares and keep selling the overpriced shares. This makes the underpriced shares increase in value and the overpriced shares decrease in value until the prices stabilize again, reflecting a new probability distribution. Let's say that news comes out that makes an outcome appear more likely. Then, potential buyers of yes shares for that outcome will be willing to accept a higher price than they were before, because they now think it's more likely they'd earn a return on their investment. Likewise, potential sellers will be more hesitant to sell for a lower price, because they don't want to lose their shares. This process is reflected in a rise in the price for those shares. The exact opposite happens if the news makes the outcome appear less likely. Buyers will only accept lower prices, and sellers will be willing to sell for less, making the price of the shares for that outcome fall. Now suppose, for instance, that news comes out that candidate Alpha is embroiled in a scandal. We can look at the price movements in the prediction markets to check whether traders think the scandal is serious. If, for example, the price for Alpha shares drops from 75 cents to 74 cents, then we can infer from this slight drop that traders don't think the scandal will matter much in the long run. On the other hand, if the price for Alpha shares goes all the way down to 10 cents, well, that's a sign that the scandal is a big deal, according to the market's participants. In this sense, prediction markets can serve as a powerful way of measuring the importance of news on the outcomes of real-world events. They're sort of like filters, allowing you to understand how crucial some recent event was, and discard it if the markets have barely moved. One might consider why we should trust prediction markets in the first place. There are many ways of understanding whether an event might happen. For example, you could read the news and listen to what reporters are saying, what the polls are showing, or what a panel of experts have predicted. But prediction markets are trustworthy because of the way they cultivate truth. By asking people to bet, prediction markets incentivize those with expertise about a given topic to come forward and trade, and actively disincentivize people who don't know much about the subject from trading. The principle at play here is easy to understand. Talk is cheap, but being wrong in a prediction market will cost you. How many times have you heard someone, such as a friend or family member, confidently assert that this or that is about to happen in the future? Many people regularly offer such predictions, whether they're about the economy, war in the Middle East, their favorite sports team, or some major disaster that they believe is about to strike the world. But in how many instances in your life have these people been right? Chances are, not many. Most people don't ordinarily keep score of how often they're right or wrong about the future, nor do they usually care a lot if they're eventually proven wrong. As a consequence, most people tend not to be careful in calibrating their expectations to the real plausibility of future events. In most contexts, people tend to be pretty overconfident about the future. In contrast, traders in prediction markets put their money where their mouth is. The best traders care a lot about what the evidence really says, finding the highest quality sources of up-to-date information about the event, and above all, not fooling themselves. Over a long enough period of time, predictors with good judgment are all that should remain in the market, because everyone else got discouraged by losing their money. That's why, in theory, we should expect prices on prediction markets to provide highly robust forecasts of events in the real world. Indeed, real-world studies have found that prediction markets are often more reliable than even expert forecasts and polling. For example, the researcher David Rothschild looked at election forecasting data from the 2008 American presidential election, pitting expert forecaster Nate Silver against the Iowa Electronic Market, a prediction market that existed at that time. What he found was that the Iowa Electronic Market beat Nate Silver's forecasts, a fact that Nate Silver himself has acknowledged. It makes sense that the prediction markets would perform better than Nate Silver's special purpose election model, since traders on prediction markets can take into account strictly more information. Nate Silver built his model using polling data, but the traders on the Iowa Electronic Market could ideally incorporate any information into their predictions, including Nate Silver's model or biases they believe it contains. Prediction markets can even help improve institutional decision making. Remember Robin Hanson from the Grabby Aliens videos? He's also done some academic work on prediction markets and how they can be used to help institutions, like governments and companies, craft better policies. His insight is to use what are called conditional prediction markets. Here's how they work. Suppose the mayor of a city wants to know whether building a new park will lead to an increase or decrease in tourism to the area. A conditional prediction market allows buyers and sellers to trade on these possibilities. We create two markets, each in regards to the same outcome. In this case, whether there will be more tourism next year compared to the current year. However, each market is conditioned on a choice that the mayor will make. The first market is only valid if the mayor decides to build a new park. The second market is the opposite. It's only valid if the mayor decides not to build a new park. If traders put their money in a market that conditions on something the mayor did not actually do, then everyone gets their money back. For example, if the mayor decides to build the park after all, then everyone who traded in the market conditioned on the mayor not building the park gets all their money back. The reason why conditional prediction markets can help craft policy comes, again, from the interpretation of their market prices. The mayor wants to know whether building a park will cause tourism to increase. Let's imagine that the market conditioned on the mayor building a park currently advertises a market price of 80 cents for tourism increasing in the following year. That roughly means that traders think there is an 80% chance that, if the mayor builds the park, tourism will increase. In contrast, if the market conditioned on the mayor not building the park advertises a price of 65 cents, we can interpret that as meaning that traders think there is only a 65% chance that if the mayor does not build the park, tourism will increase. Thus, in this case, traders think that if the mayor builds the park, the chance that tourism will increase in the following year is greater than if the mayor does not build the park. The mayor can take this information into account when making their decision. So, prediction markets are great, but they're also highly regulated, at least at the time this video is published. This regulation has limited their scope and made them less prominent, especially in the United States. That said, there have been a number of new prediction markets that have sprung up in recent years, mostly built on top of the Ethereum blockchain. The most popular choice at the moment is Augur, but there's also the recently launched Polymarket. The cryptocurrency exchange FTX also offers some prediction markets. As far as legal non-cryptocurrency exchanges go, the most popular in the United States is predictIt, which allows you to bet on events related to politics. The website electionbettingodds.com, from Maxim Lott and John Stossel, compiles pricing data from some of the most active prediction markets to provide real-time information about US political prediction markets. You may find many of the predictions there surprising. Another platform that operates in a similar way as a prediction market is Metaculus. Metaculus is not a prediction market, but it's close. It's a community forecasting platform. Instead of betting on particular outcomes, you have to directly state your probability that an event happens using a slider or input a probability distribution. Instead of money, you win or lose Metaculus points, depending on how close your probability is to the actual outcome. You're also rewarded if your probability turns out to be closer to the actual outcome than the community's probability. Over time, you become more skilled at forecasting and build a track record showing how reliable your predictions are. The scoring system on Metaculus is what's called a proper scoring rule, which means that the mathematically optimal probability to put for each question is your own subjective probability of that outcome happening. In other words, predictors are incentivized to be honest and report their true probabilities. Since it mostly doesn't involve money, Metaculus is not subject to the same regulations as prediction markets. You can predict on a wide variety of questions, and you can submit questions yourself. But there are also tournaments with cash prizes that incentivize good forecasting. It's not all points in cash prizes, though. Metaculus forecasts are also used by researchers and public health experts to support their decision making. Okay, now that you understand prediction markets, why they could aid institutional decision making, and even know some real-world implementations of them, here are some necessary caveats. First, since current prediction markets are pretty limited in scope, whether they lead to good probability estimates remains to be fully tested. Second, participating in a prediction market is, at best, a zero-sum game. Money only exchanges hands, and often there are fees. You can only expect to win money if you are better than the competition, but on average, people are expected to lose money. Prediction markets could be positive-sum for traders if subsidized, for example, by a government or company. Third, prediction markets, if implemented for aiding institutional decision-making, would not be immune to manipulation. A bad actor with a lot of money could decide to tip the balance of a policy question to obtain their preferred outcome. Using the park example again, if the bad actor wants the park to be built, they could heavily bet on the outcome that it would increase tourism to the area, thereby inflating the market's price of this outcome. If the bad actor loses money because the park doesn't end up increasing tourism, it doesn't matter to them. You can interpret their action as purchasing their preferred policy. Fourth, a prediction market stops converging on accurate probabilities if used a lot for financially hedging against certain outcomes. Let's say that a particular event, if it happens, would make someone lose a lot of money outside of the prediction market. Then they might bet on the prediction market that the event will happen, thereby making some money back if that's the case, and decreasing the financial risk that event poses to them. But even considering potential downsides, I think prediction markets hold a lot of promise, and I hope they'll be more extensively tested in the future. I'm curious to see what the future holds for prediction markets. What do you predict?
Hello everyone! For the most part, this video has been written by Matthew Barnett, a new scriptwriter. We will continue to write videos together. In this way, we will be able to write difficult and well-researched videos in a shorter time. When the channel was just starting, animation bottlenecked the video releasing schedule, but this was no longer the case after the Grab Aliens video came out. And yes, the narrator is Robert Miles, in case you're still wondering about that. I hope that we will significantly expand the team over the years, so the videos can improve a lot. And now, a big thanks to our higher tier supporters on Patreon and to our channel members, who have had the patience to support us even if videos are coming out pretty slowly. Speaking of Patreon, there is a new tier. If you choose it, you will receive a merch item every 3 months for at least a year. But also, you should be aware that we will probably begin to sell more merch in a separate store sooner or later.